the invitation. Hope next time I can give a talk in person. This has never been there. So, okay, let me start saying that what I'm going to present is some partial result, actually, not yet complete, but is a joint work with Alessandro Pigatti, which is a postdoc here. And so I'm going to talk about the Michael-Salmon inequality and for anisotropic variable, but so I will try to introduce all the terminology in the next 30-40 minutes and then tell you what we can do about it. So most of the problems I will present are somehow open, so it's just a partial result. So let me start what the classical Michael-Salmon inequality is. So Michael-Salmon inequality is very nice generalization of classical Sobolev and isoperimetric inequality. So let's say it's a geometric version. So say that we have a smooth, compact, n-dimensional surface in RD, possibly with boundary, and then we take a smooth or say C1 function, which is defined on the surface or on the whole space, doesn't change much. And then you can bound the integral of f to a suitable power by a term which involves the gradient of f, as you sort of expect, possibly a term which depends on the trace of f on the boundary, and this is like what you would expect in the classical flux situation. But then you have some terms which takes into account the fact that your surface is curving in sitting in RD. So, and this is this term involving the mean curvature of the surface, h, which just to remind you is the trace of the second fundamental form. Okay. So this is, you see that if your surface is like a flat surface into like a flat Rn into RD, then this would just boils down to the classical Sobolev inequality, and this is an extension of it. And just note maybe that, I mean, h should scale like the length to the power minus one. So the right-hand side is all homogeneous as the dimension of a length to the power n minus one, and the left-hand side as well, as it should be for any inequality to hold. And again, when you set f to be equal to one, you get a version of the isoperimetric inequality, which tells you that the area of a smooth n-dimensional surface can be bounded in terms of the area of its boundary and a term which involves the mean curvature of the surface. And okay, as you're saying, when everything is flat, it just reduces to the classical isoperimetric and Sobolev inequality. And maybe just stupid observation is that you need that mean curvature term over there, because you can just imagine the situation in which your surface doesn't have any boundary, like a sphere sitting in RD. And in this case, obviously, I mean, the area is non-zero, so you would need something on the right-hand side. And this something is indeed the mean curvature. Actually, I will show you later that basically these two terms are the same. So I can think to the mean curvature or to the boundary, it's basically the same term, okay? So before going on, I would like to give you a quick proof of the Michael-Salmon inequality, because it's instructive and it also shows you, I mean, that it's pretty rigid in a sense. So let me start again. Let me focus just in the case in which f is equal to one, the boundary is empty. And I can scale in such a way that the measure of sigma, so here, sorry, there is a measure missing. The measure of sigma is like half of the measure of the unit disk, right? The inequality was scaling invariant, so I can at least fix the scaling. And now I look to this function of the radius. So for each point of the surface, I just look to the area of the surface inside the ball of radius r, okay? And the key ingredient here is the so-called monotonicity formula, which tells you that if you look to the ratio between the area of the surface in the ball of radius r and the area of the flat n-dimensional disk, so r to the n, well, this ratio is essentially monotone, except for a term which involves the mean curvature. You might think to this, so you might think that mean curvature is like Laplacian. And so you might think to this as sort of the mean value inequality for harmonic function. So that actually, if you have an harmonic function, you know that you have a mean value inequality, and if the function is not harmonic, I mean, the remainder into the mean value inequality basically depends on the Laplacian. And that's sort of what is written here, okay? This is the geometric version of what is written here. So this is just to say again that, I mean, somehow this inequality is exploiting a lot the fact that you're dealing with something which is isotropic in a sense, because you know that the mean value inequality for Laplacian just basically holds for Laplacian. I mean, you cannot really change the differential operator and hope for something like this. So nevertheless, you have this monotonicity formula. And now I claim, using the monotonicity formula, that it is impossible that for each, that there exists a constant extremely large. I can tell you how large should be this constant, but let's say for a fixed large constant, which I'll tell you at the end of the proof, I claim that it is impossible that this function of R is larger or equal than this constant times the integral of the mean curve. So basically, for each point, there should be a radius for which the function in that radius is less than a constant times the integral of the mean curvature. Okay? Why that? Because again, assume that you have this inequality. Well, then I can plug this inequality back into the monotonicity formula and estimate the mean curvature term in terms of the U itself times a tiny constant in front. Then I just take the supremum and absorb what I have on the right-hand side. And basically I get that I can bound the supremum with the area, the supremum between R between 0 and 1 up to a small error. I can bound it by the area of the half of the full of the wall surfaces, which is half the area of the n-dimensional disk, right? But then you see that when you send R to 0, well, then your surface would resemble a flat plane. So you get that this ratio is actually the area of the n-dimensional disk, right? So, and you would have a contradiction if m is large enough. So 1 over m is small enough, okay? So this means that for each point, you can find a radius where the area of the surface is bounded by the integral of the mean curvature on the ball of the radius. So the area of the surface in that ball is bounded by the mean curvature, the integral of the mean curvature on that ball. And now it's just a covering argument to get back the Michael-Simon inequality, and then you scale back the thing. So this was, remember, you were fixing the area of the surface, then you can scale it back and get the scaling invariant version of Michael-Simon. Okay? So this is a proof, basically is almost the only proof of Michael-Simon which is around, and it's really, really relying on this monotonicity formula, okay? On the other hand, in a sense, there is another crucial consequence of monotonicity formula which can be directly deduced from Michael-Simon, and I would like to stress these consequences. The consequence is the following. So take this time a minimal surface, okay? And again, look to what is the area that this minimal surface is putting in the ball of radius R. Well, now you can apply Michael-Simon to the surfaces, which is just sigma intersected with the ball of radius R. And you get that its area to a certain power is less than the area of its boundary. Now imagine that sigma should have a boundary, but imagine that you're taking a radius reasonably small so that this ball never intersects the boundary. Well, then the boundary of the sigma intersected with R is just sigma intersected with the boundary of R. And this is basically the derivative. So the area of this is basically the derivative of your function. Okay, it's actually less or equal than the derivative of your function. So this means that for this function, so the area of sigma in the ball of radius R, you deduce a differential inequality, which if you solve it, tells you that this area is always at least a fraction of R to the n, which is telling you that basically your minimal surface cannot have tentacles. So every time you take a point on the surface and the ball of radius something which is less than the distance from that point from the boundary, then you should see a non-trivial amount of area in that ball. So your minimal surface couldn't like resemble a very tiny cylinder, right? Because if you take a very tiny cylinder, you look in a ball of radius R, well, basically where R is much larger than the diameter, than the shortest direction of the cylinder, then you see an area which is of order R, basically, not R squared, right? So that's what shouldn't happen for minimal surface. And actually, same argument essentially wouldn't happen also if you impose some, like, for instance, bounded mean curvature. I mean, the same proof would apply. So, I mean, with a constant which depends on the bound of the mean curvature, obviously. So, in a sense, again, this Michael Simon is telling you that for surfaces with controlled mean curvature, if there is a point in the surface, there should be a chunk all over, right? Or in other words, to have a tentacle, you need to pay a lot of mean curvature. That's essentially what it says, but the inequality tells you. And so, again, this estimate here goes under the name of a lower density bound. So, okay. So now, when you deal with a calculus of variation, and you know that usually in order to find solution and of various problem, it's a good strategy would be to sort of enlarge the class of things where you look for a solution, find a solution in the large class, and then possibly go back to show that into this enlarged class, I mean, the solution into this enlarged class is actually a solution of your original problem. So imagine that's what you do basically when you try to find an harmonic function via a minimization of the Dirichlet energy, right? You sort of say, okay, I'm formally an harmonic function should be a minimizer of the Dirichlet energy. I want to minimize Dirichlet energy. I realize that even if I start from smooth function, if I want to minimize Dirichlet energy, I have to deal with Sobolev function. I invent a theory of Sobolev function. I find a minimizer into the class of Sobolev functions. I know enough property of Sobolev function to be able to show that this minimizer is indeed smooth and go back, okay? And the key step here is to have some compactness, for instance, in the class of Sobolev function. So same happens into geometric problems with the exception that somehow, I mean, when you do this for linear or convex problems, the calculus of variation, in a sense, the class you're working on is a sort of convex class, in a sense. While when you deal with geometric objects, this is neither a convex nor a linear space. So things are a bit more complicated. But okay, there are a few notions. And one of these notions, which turns out to be extremely useful in certain type of problems, calculus variation, is the notion of integral variable. So the idea here is that you get a sequence of surfaces for which you have some bound on the area, and you ask yourself, okay, what could be a possible limit of this type of surface? What I can see as a possible limit? And in a sense, you start realizing that you also care about what could be not just the possible limit, if you want, of the surface measures, but also of the tangent plane. So you would like to get an information also on the asymptotic distribution of the tangent plane. So this leads quite naturally to the notion of variable, which is just a measure on the Grassmannian, okay, in which you should think like the RD component to be like the surface measure, and the Grassmannian component to be basically the tangent plane distribution. And if you have a smooth surface, you can naturally associate to it a variable because, I mean, the surface, in each point, you have a unique tangent plane. So your measure will be like the surface measure times a delta. At each point x, you have a delta sitting on that tangent plane, okay? So basically, it's a measure which is on a graph, okay? So you have the graph. So you have a surface. The surface induces a graph into the Grassmannian, just to each point you associate the tangent plane, and you just basically push forward on this graph the measure on the surface, okay? So this is a very good measure on the Grassmannian, and now you can look to a limit of surfaces, you can associate what should be the limit of these measures on the Grassmannian, everything, I mean, class of measure is being situated, basically every problem is as compactness in that class. And now your question is which type of measure I can get. So if I start with a sequence of smooth surfaces on which I have maybe some bound on the area or on their mean curvature, what type of measures I can get? So for those which are a bit more in calculus of variation, these are like Young measures. So for those who know what they are, this is really the same thing that looking at Young measures, essentially. Anyhow, there is a, as you're saying, the first natural generalization to the class of measure associated with surface is what they're, what is called the class of integral of rectifiable variable, in which this time you don't have a surface, but you have what is called a rectifiable sets, which you can think like a countable union of surfaces. So you can define somehow the tangent plane, and again, just have this set times for each point, you have almost each point, you have a tangent plane, and you put the delta over there. And maybe you put some density. So you weight everything with the measure, with the density theta. This might seems reasonable that when you take a limit of surface, you should get object like this. I mean, it's easy to construct object like this as limits of sequence of surfaces with bounded area and bounded mean curvature. And that's one of the reasons why you have to deal with union, right? Because imagine that the surface is smooth things, which is just adding every time, like you take a ball, then you add another ball, a second, a third ball, and in the end you would get like a countable union of both. So this would need to be in your class. You also need some density because maybe you have two surfaces collapsing one onto the other. So at the end, the area would be count as twice as much. But do you need more, in a sense, is the question. So do you, can you exit from the taking limit of this type of smooth surfaces? Can you exit the class of rectifiable variable? And the answer is basically no. Okay, before that, I need to introduce another notion, which is the notion of, so I was saying I want to talk about sequence of surfaces with bounded mean curvature. So now I would like to get them to extend the notion of mean curvature in a setting where I cannot take any too many derivatives. So what I'm gonna do is I take a variable, and now I take to the variation, so I can define what is the area of the variable. You just integrate basically your measure. And now I take a deformation of the variable via a one parameter family of diffeomorphisms. I look to the area of the deformed variables and I differentiate these things with respect to time. And what I get is basically a distribution which acts on the initial velocity of my family of diffeomorphisms. And it depends linearly on it. So I get the first order one distribution, which I call first variation, okay? And I can also explicitly represent it. And the point is that when I have a smooth surface, this order one distribution just boils down to the classical mean curvature, which is indeed the first variation of the area, plus the terms which sits on the boundary of the surface, which you should think is reasonable because if you'd like, imagine that even if you have like a flat disk sitting into a flat two-dimensional disk, which sits into a tree, and now your vector field is basically a dilation of the disk in the plane where the disk is sitting. But you see that basically the area, the area, if you move by epsilon, the area is like proportional, the area you're adding is like proportional to epsilon times the area of the boundary. It's actually equal. So you see that this boundary term takes into account the fact that when you deform in certain direction close to the boundary, you are adding area linearly, usually in epsilon. So you get both type of terms. And maybe the other good thing to notice is that that's what I was saying, is that they basically, so mean curvature and boundary, they sort of live on the same footage. Okay. So in particular, you can define what is, you can write the Michael-Simon inequality for a very, in for this type of variable in a very concise way. And by basically the same proof, you can extend the Michael-Simon inequality to every variable. To every rectifiable variable, sorry, where when you impose at least that the density is larger or equal than one or any constant. And you need this because you see, I was saying that Michael-Simon inequality is a good inequality because everything scales correctly as it should. But now in our class of variables, we have a further symmetry, which, well, symmetry is not really symmetry. We have a further parameter we can scale things, which is we can multiply the variable by a constant, right? This should be still a variable. And now you see that the inequality as it's written is not homogeneous in the variable. right? If you multiply by a constant, the constant would goes out, pops out on the left and right hand side with different powers. So to have an inequality like that to be true, you have to take care of this fact. And it's easy to see that basically if you make put a lower density and if you impose a lower bound on the density, then this constant you multiply with should be large, cannot be small, has to be large, and the inequality would still hold if you multiply by large constant. Actually, it would become quite stronger, more and more true. So, okay. So that's what's proved by Allard. What was proved by Allard, and the proof was basically the same because you have the analogous of a monotonicity formula, is basically the same that I gave to you. So you have a Michael-Simon inequality for a rectifiable variable. And this inequality is a key step in proving this compactness theorem for rectifiable variables. So say that you have a sequence of rectifiable variables with density lower bounded, and for which you have a control on the area and control on the mean curvature, essentially, so on the first variations. Well, then up to subsequence, then you have the sequence converges to a variable, and this is easy. It's just basically Banach-Kalogloo. But the key point here is that the limit variable is rectifiable. So in other words, as I was saying, if you start with sequence of decent object, like smooth surfaces, you impose a bound on the area, you impose a bound on mean curvature, well, then the limit guy you get cannot be too crazy, right? So this is why this compactness theorem is important. Indeed, more than a compactness theorem should be taught as a closure theorem. It tells you that, in a sense, the class of rectifiable variable is the largest class of you should care, right? So if, in a sense, if you take the closure of this of smooth surfaces, you end up in this class. So you don't want to look to things which are too exotic, right? Because that's the problem when you enlarge the problem too much. Right? When you enlarge the class, you're looking solution for the problem too much, maybe you find solution which has nothing to do with your original problem. So you always, it's always a balance, right? How much you want to enlarge, because the more you enlarge, the easier it is to find the solution, with how much you want to keep the interesting feature of your original problem. Okay, and that's the balance which is there in calculus variation somehow. Okay, and the proof of this theorem is actually based on two ingredients, essentially. The first one is the Michael-Simon inequality, and the second one is a compactness criteria for, a rectifiability criteria for variables, which is still due to Allard, the same paper, in which it showed that once you have a variable, which is for which the first variation is indeed an ordered zero distribution, essentially. That's what is written there. So if you remember, the first variation a priori is an order one distribution. Here I'm requiring it to be an order zero. So it's a regularity assumption in a sense on the first variation. So which you can think like for surfaces, like have a good bound on mean curvature, like an L1 bound on the mean curvature. Well, then the variable is rectifiable, at least is rectifiable when you restrict it to the set of points where the density, the n-dimensional density is positive. So which is the actual n-dimensional part of a variable. So the key point here is that in a sense, this type of variable, they can be more spread than something which is n-dimensional, but they cannot be less spread than something. So if you have a two-dimensional variable, this it might not be two-dimensional, but it cannot be more than less than two-dimensional. It cannot like resemble a line. It should resemble something which is two-dimensional or more. And actually, you can have very precise structure. So if you somehow kill the higher dimensional parts, and that's the role of restricting yourself to this set, well, then you really see something which is two-dimensional. Okay. And that part is rectifiable. And then the role of Michael-Simon now is to use the lower density bound I was mentioning to you before. And this lower density bound, since they do not depend on anything, they sort of pass to the limit. So if you start with something which is two-dimensional, you cannot end up with something which is higher than two-dimensional. So in a sense, you know that part where theta star is positive, it coincides with everything. And that's what gives you that the limiting variable is indeed rectifiable. So maybe this is a good moment to stop to see if you have any questions. Okay, so if not, again, let's move on and just let me notice that the proof of this theorem relies strongly on monotonicity formula in two ways. I mean, on the one hand, it relies on the monotonicity formula because of the Michael-Simon inequality, which relies itself on the monotonicity formula. And not only, there are another, I mean, that even, okay, the compactness relies on the, in a sense, the compactness theorem relies twice on monotonicity formula, one on because of Michael-Simon inequality, and one because of this rectifiability criterion, which again, to be proved, requires monotonicity formula, okay? So this is somehow what we know. There is a nice observation, which apparently has never been done, which is that Michael-Simon inequality is indeed equivalent to the compactness for rectifiable variable. And the proof is extremely easy and goes via contradiction. So assume that Michael-Simon inequality fails. Well, then basically, I mean, if you take a sequence of things along which it's failing and you exploit the compactness theorem, you find this for each small constant C, you find the rectifiable variable VC for which the masses over is equal to C, the first variation is zero and the density is at least one. Okay. So now, and here the key point is that these are rectifiable. So now you can take this family of variables, VC, you divide by C. Again, you see that the mass is going to be one. The first variation is still zero, obviously. And the density is at least one over C, so it's at least one because C is small. And now if you send C to zero, this is a class of rectifiable variable for which you cannot actually extract a converging subsequence. Okay, so basically because the density is becoming infinite everywhere. So this is a contradiction with the compactness theorem. So compactness theorem implies Michael-Simon inequality. And the two are thus equivalent. Together with the rectifiability criterion. Okay, so proving Michael-Simon inequality should be as hard as proving the compactness theorem for rectifiable variable. And now, so this is the first part of explains somehow the first part of the title of the talk, which is the Michael-Simon inequality. So now let me move to the second part, which is what it's about anisotropic. Minimal surfaces, in a sense, and okay, here in the audience, we have probably one of the experts. So, but for the other people, so let me start saying that. So, the area functional is an extremely natural object to study because I mean, it's like several even physical systems are just driven by surface tensions, and surface tension energy are like. To be proportional to the area at the first order, but there are several other situations in which actually also orientation matters. So that's, for instance, the case for crystals in which different directions are weighted differently. So the area of a part of the surface which has a certain normal might be less than the area of the part of the surface which has different normal. So this means that this time you want to look to functionals which depends also on the tangent plane. So instead of integrating a function one on all the surface to get the area, you integrate a function which might depend on the orientation of the surface, okay? And that's what I'm gonna call an anisotropic functional. And I mean, since it depends just on the surface and on its tangent plane, it can be extended immediately to the class of variables via this formula. And this is an anisotropic functional. And same way, I can define what is the first variation of this anisotropic functional. And this turns out to be a generalized mean curvature in a sense, so that if you do this to a smooth surface, if you compute what it is to a smooth surface, what you're gonna get is instead of, it's a different weighted average of the second fundamental form, at least in the codimensional one set. Okay. So in a sense, going from area functional to anisotropic functional is the same step you have going from integral Dirichlet integral to the integral of any integral of f of gradient u in the calculus of variation. And for those which are a bit into the calculus of variation, you know that there are several, I mean, in a sense, you're losing linearity, or to be more precise, you're losing isotropy. And this is several, I mean, the two things are really non-comparable, okay? So there is no easy way to translate the sort of Laplace theory to the class of nonlinear equations. So you sort of pass from linear to nonlinear equation, and here is sort of the same, though already the area functional is a nonlinear object, but in a sense, this is more nonlinear, if you want. Okay, but nevertheless, there are important in application. And the key point here is that basically, for this type of functional, there is no hope to have a monotonicity formula. Okay, for the same way, when you have a nonlinear variational problem, there is no hope to have a monotonistic formula, essentially. Here is the same. So, and but up to now, monotonistic formula was the main tool to deduce all the possible theorem. And so it's a very natural question, which dates back to the work of Allard, whether you can extend Michael-Simon inequality to the class of to the anisotropic setting. So instead of bounding the area of your variable by the its first variation, whether you can bound it by the anisotropic first variation. And here in this conjecture, I'm requiring the functional to be elliptic, but this is a very, okay, this is a, this conjecture in this way is very loose because I haven't defined what elliptic means, and I'm not sure I know what elliptic means in the sense that when you go to high codimension, there are several notions of ellipticity. There are implications among them sometimes. They are not all equivalent. I have no idea what would be the good notion of ellipticity, but at least I'm pretty sure that when I'm working in codimension one, so like surfaces into R3, well, the good notion of ellipticity should be convexity. Okay. So this, because basically in codimension one, all notion of ellipticity boils down to convexity. So I'm pretty sure that in that case, the quite good condition could be convexity. Higher codimension, I would be happy, and convexity would be the strongest one. I would be happy to prove anything also under this assumption, but maybe it'd be possible with weaker one. It's not even clear. I mean, this is a conjecture, so it's not even clear whether elliptic. So we don't have any counterexample, even if ellipticity creates at the moment. So this would be interesting. So this is what one looked for. And as I was saying, there is no monotonicity formula, so there is no hope to extend the proof of the Michael-Simon proof to the setting. And the other thing is that I'm stating everything in the setting of variable because that's the class of object I'm interested. But actually the problem is completely open even for smooth surfaces. So it's not a problem of extending something to the non-smooth setting. It's just we have no idea how to do this even for smooth things, okay? So in particular, I mean, a very easy version would be, well, it would be a slightly strong version would be imagining that you have a two-dimensional surface into R3, and you know basically that the two principal curvature have opposite sign and they are comparable, I mean, absolute value. Can you prove an inequality like this? So can you basically bound the area in terms of the boundaries. Okay. I was saying this is not known. Okay, even for smooth surface. So at least we have something which is known in this setting, which is again, so Michael-Simon inequality. I mean, my proof that Michael-Simon inequality was equivalent to compactness. can be extended immediately to the setting of an isotropic particle. That one works fine. So understanding whether Michael Simon inequality is true is basically the same to understanding whether we have a compactness theorem for variables when you have a control on the anisotropic first variation. Okay. And actually was the main interest I had. So the main reason I was interested in Michael Simon inequality was really to deal with this problem. And it turned out that they are equivalent. So there was no cheap way I could escape from. So I was really interested in the compactness problem. And Michael Simon inequality, for a while, I thought was just a tool to use, I mean, to try to prove in order to get it. Then we realized it was really equivalent. So there is no way we can avoid to go through it. Which, I don't know, it makes things, harder, but at least more interesting. But as I was saying, one of the reasons is that at least the rectifiability criterion can be proved. So the rectifiability criterion of Allard can be extended to an isotropic variable. And this was done by myself together with Antonio De Rosa and Francesco Giraldins like 5 years ago. And the statement is exactly the same of the one of Allard. So maybe the only point is that, I mean, since I was telling you that the proof of Allard was relying strongly on monotonicity formula, and in this case, you don't have any monotonicity formula, well, obviously, there is a proof here which does not rely on monotonicity formula, which is gives you also a new proof of class, the theorem of Allard. So it's more like it's a new proof of that theorem, and again, I was saying that this implies Michael Simon. That theorem is what makes Michael Simon equivalent to the compactness statement, and. The key point here, in a sense, okay, so Michael Simon is equivalent to compactness, and in a sense, to compactness for rectifiable variable, and in a sense, here you have this thing that rectifiability is a qualitative statement. So it's like saying that something is differentiable everywhere or almost everywhere. It's like differentiability in a sense, rectifiability. Okay, so you basically just requiring the existence of some tangent plane. Now, compactness is about a quantitative statement, right? You need to quantify how much you are differentiable in order to get compactness, okay? So if you think to the classical compactness theorem, which is Ascoli-Herzelai, it's basically prescribing you some derivative and gives you compactness, okay? Or like Sobolev, like Rayleigh compactness theorem, it just tells you, okay, if I have some bound on some derivative, I get compactness. So you see here that we are able to prove a qualitative statement, so rectifiability, but we aim to prove a quantitative statement. So one can try to quantify, in order to get Michael Simon inequality, one can try to quantify our rectifiability proof. That's a possible strategy. And okay, I won't go through the whole proof, but there is a key step in our proof, which is that, well, actually it was not the original proof, but it's almost, and this is, this step comes in as different proof we gave of the same result, but not that different, but different framework with Adolfo Arroyo-Rabasa, Jonas Hirsch, and Philip Ringler. So one of the key points is that basically for almost all planes, when you project your variable on that plane, what you see is something which is absolutely continuous with respect to the measure associated to that plane. So this is a key step in the rectifiability criterion, and it's basically the thing you would like to quantify. And the proof of this fact is based on two major steps. Sorry. So the first one is that when you project it, when you look to this projected measure, well, you can leverage the fact that your variable was at a good control on the mean curvature, the anisotropic mean curvature, to show that basically this measure is solving a PDE, so a first order PDE. And actually it's a system of PDEs, so which can be stated as follows. So you have a matrix B for which the divergence of this matrix times this measure is indeed a measure. So let's say it's zero. You can think this to be zero. Now, this in principle looks a terrible PD, right? Because it's a first order PD for a divergence, for the divergence, and we know that, I mean, this in general is an underdetermined system, so you have a lot of solution, no hope to gain any regularity for it. But here, the key point is that this matrix is invertible, and that the measure is scalar. So actually, for this measure, this becomes n, so you have one variable, the measure, and you have n equations, each of which, I mean, sort of independent. So this makes the system much more close to be elliptic, and it actually is, in a sense, an elliptic system. So imagine that this matrix is constant. Basically, what you are requiring here is a control on all of n independent derivative of your measure, which you see would give you a full control on the measure, okay? So if the matrix is constant, it's immediate to see that such a system is elliptic, and if it's not constant, I mean, okay, we have to decide what does it mean to be elliptic, but in a sense, still can give you something. And indeed, what gives you is that the measure is absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure, okay? It's a very weak form of regularity, if you want. Then you cannot get much better than this. So this is the key step, in a sense, in solving the rectifiability, improving the rectifiability criteria. And so it seems natural to sort of be able to quantify these steps, right? And in a sense, so say that your matrix is enough invertible, so it's quantitatively invertible, and you have a good control on the divergence, can you say that your measure is enough absolutely continuous, so maybe it's in some LP space? And now if you play a bit with what can be true, what can be false, you are led to this conjecture somehow in which, like at least in terms of a priori estimate, that if you have a nice matrix field, then you can bound its determinant to suitable power, the integral of the determinant by the integral of the divergence. And let me assume that the determinant is always positive so that I don't have issues. And you see that this is a quantification of what I was saying before, because imagine that you are in a region where the matrix is really invertible, well, then the determinant of the matrix should be like the matrix to the power n. And what you have on the left-hand side is a power higher than one of the matrix, and you're bounding the divergence. So this looks like a Sobolev inequality, right? If you think the divergence to be the gradient. So on the other end, when the matrix stops being invertible, like the left-hand side is just zero, so, well, the inequality would be true. And now the question is, would be true in between? And the answer is no, in general. I mean, if you state it just like this, it's false, the inequality. But there are situations in which it turns out to be true. For instance, it's true when, if the matrix is symmetric and positive. And this was observed by Deniser some years ago. And actually, you can use this fact to give a new proof of the isotropic Michaels-Zahman inequality. So at least this strategy seems to work in one case. So the problem is that here the isotropy is hidden in the fact that the matrix you obtain, if you start with the isotropic area functional, the matrix you obtain is indeed symmetric and positive, while this is false if you don't have the area function, okay? So, okay, so this conjecture this way seems to be a bit optimistic, but nevertheless, it might be that in our situation, for the type of matrix field we have, this conjecture holds true. Well, actually, this is sort of true in the sense that at least, okay, the inequality still is false, but nevertheless allows you, I mean, that's some variant of it, which I'll come soon, allows to prove a version of the Michaels-Zahman inequality, at least in a particular case, which is when the dimension of the ambient space is three, the surface is two-dimensional. So you have a two-dimensional variable into R3, and that would be okay. And the unfortunate part is that you need to assume that your anisotropy is close enough to the area. Actually, close enough is wrong. I mean, it's close. So this epsilon zero, you can even compute it. It's like square root of 2. So it's not that small number. Okay, doesn't make much sense to say what is small, what is big, but it's not so small in a sense, it's a not so small number, for which if you're, so let's say the correct statement would be, if your anisotropy is at some sort of bounded distance from the area, well, then the Michaels-Samuel inequality goes through. And so this is what we proved with Alessandro, and actually in the proof, and I'll tell you where, we rely a lot of some idea which were introduced in a manuscript by, so this, which we found in a manuscript of Angren, which was unpublished, and that Gene Taylor shared with us some years ago. So yeah, I would say it's fair to put Angren among the authors as well, in a sense. So you have this version, so this is slightly stronger than Michaels-Samuel inequality, but it's not really the point. So the inequality you get here, you know that this time is scaling properly in the variables, but it's easy to see that if you have a lower density bound, then you recover the Michaels-Samuel inequality out of this. So that's what you can prove. And although we have some this sort of perturbative assumption, the proof is not really perturbative. So it's not that you take the classical proof of Michaels-Samuel or the classical Michaels-Samuel and you say, okay, let me take care of some reminder. So those reminders, they're really bad. I mean, if you try to write them as a reminder, you're stuck immediately. The problem is that the monotonicity formula are extremely, the proof of monotonicity formula is extremely unstable. So if you change some constant to be going from one to be one plus epsilon, well, then what doesn't happen is not that you're in the monotonicity formula, usually are changing the exponents, okay? So instead of having the area over r to the n to be like monotone, you get the area over r to the n minus epsilon to be monotone. So monotonicity form, so since these are differential inequality of sort of logarithmic type, if you change the constant, you're changing the exponent actually. So you cannot take the proof of monotonicity formula and just perturb it. That wouldn't work. So you have to find another proof and perturb it. That's sort of the idea. And actually the proof is based on the principle I was mentioning to you and to this slightly generalized version of Serre's inequality, which works just in two dimensions. And so you have a matrix field you have with positive determinant, and now you are imposing that the element on the diagonal are positive as well. And now you can bound the integral of the determinant by basically the integral of the divergence. Okay, so actually you can put this form with the divergence of the single rows, but that's not really important. So this is somehow one of the key steps in our proof. And this explained the last part of the title. I'm not sure, because I'm changing the title of the talk. So I don't know, but I want to mention, see if this was in the actual title I sent to Connor, but there is a link between this inequality and the classical multilinear Kakei inequality. So in a sense, this is a sort of nonlinear version of the multilinear Kakei inequality. So this is an inequality which we used for several estimates in harmonic analysis, was introduced by Bennett, Carberry, and Tao, and was actually proved by Larry Goods. And in a sense, this is an inequality about thick lines. So imagine that your family of lines in RD, so the family of sort of independent lines in RD, and you look to cylinders along these lines. So you have a family, the family, like imagine two dimension, you have two family of cylinders, rectangles then, which one family which somehow points in the horizontal direction, one family which points in the vertical direction, and you would like to understand what is the measure of the intersection of these families. Okay, and the Kakei inequality basically allows you to bound the measure of this intersection with the cardinality of this family. So actually the product of the cardinality of this family with correct powers, which in dimension two are the one I wrote here. And actually in dimension two, the multilinear Kakei inequality is really elementary, and the hard part of the multilinear Kakei inequality is in dimension higher than two. But our inequality is a sort of a nonlinear version of multilinear Kakeia, because we don't need to care about the intersection, and indeed we can recover multilinear Kakeia from that, because we don't care about the intersection of just of cubes, but of like thick lines, but we care also about the intersection of thick curves. So if you think that these curves like sort of represents like a thick net version of the, so B1 and B2 are like the two row of your matrix, and you look to their, so these are two vector fields, and you look to their flow line, and you thicken those flow line a tiny bit, well, then basically our inequality is giving you some control on the area of the intersection in terms of the area of the thickness of these lines. That's, I mean, you can, if these are really like flow tubes, that's really what is written in our inequality. And you can leverage this fact to actually prove the inequality. So, which already is not completely trivial. So in a sense, you go from proving, so multilinear KKA in dimension two is trivial. It's already non-trivial when you look to the sort of nonlinear version. And what is unfortunate is that seems that the nonlinear version of multilinear KKA is just false, plainly false in higher dimension. So this strategy doesn't look too promising then. But at least once you have it, that inequality in two dimension, you can sort of run the argument I was telling you and try to get the Michael-Sumner inequality. So actually there is a big issue here, which is the following. So, and that's where this epsilon appear. So in a sense, it's not hard to reduce to the case in which the coefficients on the diagonal are positive for the matrix. So this comes from ellipticity in a sense. So that part you can get, but what just is plainly false is that the determinant is positive. So there is, so now how to deal with this? Well, here is where the idea of Almgren comes into play. So in a sense, you can reduce yourself. There is a non-trivial part where the determinant is positive. But this wouldn't be enough because in a sense, this flow line can enter in the region where the determinant is positive, then exit, then re-enter, then exit, then re-enter, and this is, would be extremely annoying. So the key idea of Almgren would be basically to look to these flow lines and just look them once to the part in which once they enter in the region where the determinant is positive, they never exit. And what is surprising in a sense is that if you just restrict yourself to this set, okay, the fact that once you restrict yourself to this set, you get the right estimate is not hard, but that this is enough. So that this set is big enough, it's somehow surprising. And this comes from a still bit mysterious estimate, which we borrowed from him, which in a sense, this set is quite big for the area. And now you have some space to for the area function, and now you have some space to perturb it, and that's why the epsilon zero comes. So basically, you have an inequality which for the area it holds with constant 1/3. You will be happy if the inequality holds with constant up to 1/4, and then you have that space essentially. So you have the same space which goes from 1/3 to 1/4 to play with, and that's how you actually prove the inequality and where that epsilon zero comes from. And I think with this, I conclude the talk, and thanks a lot.